to another episode of Candid Moments with Candace Kirkbride. Today I have a special guest. Anthony works as a teacher, author, and motivational speaker. He is the recipient of the Courage to Come Back Award from the Center for Addictions and Mental Health in Toronto after sustaining a traumatic brain injury following a very serious motorcycle accident. Anthony was in a coma for 2 weeks and not expected to live. Through his persistence and determination, Anthony has been able to recover to the capacity to function effectively despite the overwhelming odds against him. His story of recovery was featured on the cover story of Reader's Digest in July 2002. He's the author of 4 popular books, one of which is called Rethink, Redo, Rewired. Until today, we'll highlight that. Using alternative treatments to heal a brain injury, which highlights his journey from survivor to thriver. 8 years after his accident, Anthony graduated from the University of Toronto with a Master of Education in Applied Cognitive Science with a specialization in brain injuries. He lives in Toronto with his wife, Jennifer, and their 2 cats. Please help me welcome to the microphone, Anthony Aquanasi. Hi, Anthony.
Hi there. Thank you very much, Candace.
Oh, you're welcome. How are you?
I'm good, thanks. A little tired, but I'm okay, though. Thank you.
Oh, good. Is it raining over there?
No. We had a very sunny morning. I was out for a walk with my wife, but it does starting to look like there's clouds coming, so you might be right about rain.
It was sunny here this morning, and then all of a sudden the clouds rolled in, and it's raining a little bit, and I felt it like last week, but I'm sure you can attest to that.
Yeah.
Can I just point out, I am so glad we are wearing the same team. I love it. I survived the ICU. I love it. I bought this from you when you spoke at, you were a keynote speaker at the Brain Injury Association. It was in Sudbury. It was probably over a decade ago, I want to say. We're in 21. If that was 11, I don't even know what year.
I don't know. I honestly can't remember when I spoke there.
it's been some time.
I do remember meeting you and you purchasing that shirt. I was really happy, and it's something that I've been trying to promote. And I think we survivors really need to broadcast that we survived something that's horrific. Not many people survive the ICU, so I think this is something that for all of us to be proud of.
Absolutely, that we wear that as a badge of honor.
Yeah, absolutely.
So out of the 4 books that you wrote, the newest one is Rethink, Redo, Rewired, is that
true? Yeah.
Okay, and the one thing that I forgot to put in your intro, I think this is absolutely amazing. You are such a rock star. You shared the stage with Dr. Wayne Dyer. Oh
yeah.
My gosh, that's a bucket list item. When was that and where?
Oh, that was in Toronto here. Oh, years ago, over 10 years. It was several years after my accident.
Okay.
And I've always been a big Wayne Dyer fan. Even prior to my accident, I was reading his books and very motivated by his talks. And then after my accident, it was Dr. Wayne Dyer's books that gave me the motivation to determine to try to teach myself to read again, because that was a skill and ability that I lost from my accident. I couldn't read because my eyes, it was so difficult. It's not that I lost the ability, because being able to process the information, the words, I couldn't remember what the words would mean. And my eyes couldn't focus on the very small print, and I was dizzy a lot. And so I just gave up because it was such an onerous task to read. But when I saw Dr. Dyer's book one day lying on the floor, And I was like, man, I've got to read that again. I've got to try to read. So it's his books that really, it really motivated me and gave me the drive to really persist through the difficulties and try to actually get myself, rewire my brain to start being able to read. And I did that. And the friend that I was, well, my one friend, his name is Sam. Was I living with him at the time, Max? I think I might've been. Oh no, I can't remember. But anyway, Sam and I were big Wayne Dyer fans. And we actually were supposed to, we bought tickets to go see Wayne Dyer present at a conference in Toronto at the time that I had a motorcycle accident. Okay. So he started his presentation. I was in a coma in the ICU. And so obviously I couldn't go, but my friend Sam, he still had the tickets. So we went to the presentation. And then after the presentation, you know, Wayne Dyer typically has lots of fans coming up in a long line to get Wayne to sign their books that they just purchased. And my friend Sam joined that line. And when he got to speak to Wayne Dyer, he said, listen, my friend Anthony, he's a really big fan of yours. He was supposed to be at this presentation today, but he couldn't because I was in a bad motorcycle accident. Could you please just say some words or say something of kindness for him to help him? Because Wayne has done that for so many other people and he's helped people heal themselves. And then he asked my friend Sam, where was Anthony as a patient? And Sam told him that I was at St. Michael's Hospital. And lo and behold, Wayne Dyer took it upon himself to go visit me when I was in a coma in the intensive care unit. And he said, he came to my bedside. Actually, when he was coming into the unit, which you're only supposed to go into the unit if you're an official doctor or if you've received permission to come in. Right. And he hadn't received. And so the nurse who encountered Wayne said, excuse me, sir, are you a doctor? And Dr. Wayne Dyer said, yeah. He wasn't lying. He's not a medical doctor, but he said, yes. And so the nurse didn't say anything else. And he came to my bedside. She directed him where to go. And he just stood by my bedside. And he said he prayed and he meditated at my bedside. And he said he brought pardon to injury. And so after that, you know, he didn't know what happened to me. And he went on his business and flying back to his home in the States. And then several years after that, I have showed up at one of his conferences, you know, to hear him. And I was with my friend Sam. And when Dr. Dyer saw me, he instantly recognized me. And he was like, oh my God, Anthony, you got to come up on stage and talk. Well, he asked me to come speak to his audience and talk about how I've used a lot of Dr. Wayne Dyer's principles and strategies to help myself. And so that was a real honor. And I've seen him at multiple conferences, and it was great to establish that relationship, just a recognition. And he recognized me, and I was really sad when he passed away.
Yeah.
But so many positive messages and lessons that we here in society can use. And hopefully we continue to use those messages, even though he's gone. I mean, but it's his daughters, I believe, they're carrying on his work. It's wonderful.
Yeah, I follow like his legacy online, and his daughters do post all of his quotes continuously, which is so nice to see. And he's left his footprint on this earth with all of his teachings. If anybody is familiar with Wayne Dyer and you were to ask what your favorite book was, well, you can't just choose one. He wrote over probably over 20, 30, 40 books.
Yeah.
It was amazing. That is so great that you got to share the stage with him.
Yeah, he's awesome. And I'm trying to remember the book, but he wrote about my story in one of his books, and he included my name. I was really privileged to see that. I mean, my name's written up in his book. The memory of the book, I can't remember. It's upstairs in my, but anyway, so it's,
amazing.
I'll send that as an email to you once.
Okay, thanks.
It's,
so what the new book, Rethink, Redo, Rewired. For everybody who doesn't know you and what your philosophies are, like, what does it mean? What is it all about? And what inspired the title? What brought you to do this?
Okay, well, what inspired me first, I'll address that. I was, I work as an elementary school teacher, and at school we deal with a variety of different things and lots of challenges. And one of which, on this one particular day, I was walking back to the school after I went out for lunch, and there was this improperly functioning gate at the school. And instead of, you push on the gate and it's supposed to open up, it's mechanically, it's a mechanical device that's supposed to open up. And it didn't open up. In fact, it opened up a bit and came swinging back and smashed me in the head and knocking me out. And I was knocked out at school. I was lying on the ground. My head was bleeding. I was knocked out. And when I came to, everyone, there was nobody around because school was in session. And I could barely walk. So I crawled to the front of the school, and I was able to get myself into the front office, and they saw me and they immediately wanted me to go to the hospital. And I had to. So I went to the hospital, and there I sustained another brain injury, and it was just torture. Oh. This was like 15 or 16 years after my very first accident.
Okay.
And so then I had to go through all the rehab again. I was off school for a long time because I couldn't teach, and all the same problems that I had in the original stages after my motorcycle accident came right back to me, and it was incredibly difficult, you know, memory, concentration, cognitive skills, emotional problems, fatigue, sleep problems, you name it, I had it. And it was so difficult.
Was it worse the second time around?
No, it wasn't worse, but it was, I mean, I didn't have to have surgery or anything.
Right.
But the doctors at the hospital that I went to, they did the CAT scans and all the initial assessments, and they said, yes, you've sustained another brain injury. And so I didn't have to end up into an intensive care unit, but I was basically bedridden at home and, you know, just away from all sensory stimulation to allow my brain to heal. So anyway, so I had to go through lots of different treatment, and I started seeing the doctors again, but that became so frustrating because the conventional Western medical doctors, they push a lot of pharmaceuticals, they push a lot of drugs, and nothing really that's really helping get to the root cause of the problem. And so I started to see, I was getting very frustrated with that, and the treatment and the long waits, and I was so impatient too. So I started to see a neuropsychologist, and the neuropsychologist has a specialty in the brain and brain injuries. And she was very alternative. She wasn't right for conventional medicine. Conventional Western medicine is like North American medicine. The doctors in Canada and the United States, and they have a list of drugs that they prefer to prescribe. And she was very alternative, and she preferred alternative ways to healing the brain. And she introduced me to something called neurological feedback, which is a great feedback for the brain. And it was just amazing what it was able to do with me. And I was so amazed. So I basically stopped all sort of conventional medical doctors, but I started to see her for help and to deal with these problems.
So neurofeedback, I remember that this lady Lise, who worked for my psychologist at the time during rehab, she did this and she made it so much fun. Like, rehab sucks, it's not fun, but they do their best to try to make it fun for the patient. But what did you find neurofeedback fun?
I loved it. I mean, I found it so relaxing, so peaceful.
Can you describe like what is it? Like, I know what it is.
They attach different electrodes to your brain. And what it's doing, it's analyzing the brain waves that are taking place. And they're seeing where there's a dysfunction, because a brain that's been injured, it's going to be have a frequency at an abnormal level, abnormal rate, as opposed to what the normal frequency would be for a non-injured brain. And they're doing different things to push your brain to try to heal itself. Basically, your brain can heal itself if given the right direction. And she used a different music. And you're
looking at a screen.
Yeah.
And you have to focus your brain. Like
you're concentrating really hard.
Yeah, you're concentrating to make like the line, like the brain waves match the brain, like the music kind of.
Yeah.
And it affected my left side. So for my hand, she would get me to pick up little things like alleys and put them like in that spot, or like small things where I was using my fine motor skills. But at the same time, I'm trying to calm down to make the brain waves match.
So you were looking at a screen too?
Yeah. Were you looking at a screen?
Yeah, I was just amazed by it and how it really helped me. And so I continued seeing her. And then she recommended, she gave me some more recommendations about different devices. These are alternative devices that I can use. Cranial electrical therapy stimulation is another alternative form of treatment where you're stimulating the brain through some electrodes that are attached to your ears.
Okay.
And then she referred me to see this other doctor named Dr. Khan for something called laser therapy.
I saw that on your website. I've never participated in that.
Yeah, it's awesome. I mean, it's phenomenal because with this doctor actually, he was a conventional medical, he was a surgeon in the States.
Okay.
And he somehow went through the same difficulties because he had a skiing accident and he damaged his shoulder, and he wanted to be able to get the mobility back in his shoulder. And he found out that at that time there was a laser therapy device that helped him greatly. So because he was a doctor and he had these sort of abilities and contacts, he was able to start his own, start the focus of his practice on using laser therapy. And laser therapy is a non-invasive sort of treatment where it's actually dealing in all sorts of areas of the brain or the rest of the body and allowing the body to heal itself. Because the premise behind laser therapy, it's a very strong laser. It's not going to be like a laser with Buck Rogers or something, or from Star Wars, where you're going to see it's a low intensity light that you have to protect your eyes from, but the rest of your body benefits greatly because in our cells, every cell of our body has what's called the mitochondria. The mitochondria are the factories or the furnaces of the cell, and they help the cell give the cell energy. And what happens with the injured cells is that many they're not providing the energy that's needed or necessary for the cells to heal themselves. What laser therapy does, the premise behind laser therapy is that it increases the work of the mitochondria, and it helps them so that they're going to be more restored and providing more energy to the cells. More energy to the cells further increases one's ability to rehabilitate and recover from various injuries.
That could be like soft tissue injury as well.
Yeah, I went to see him specifically for the brain injury problems, and he was able to help me with that. But then anytime I had a skeletal problem or like a knee injury, I've had knee injuries because of my motorcycle accident, he would address that using laser therapy. And it's just amazing. And in his office, he's treated people from the football teams, the baseball, professional baseball teams. And it's been very, very helpful. And it's no drugs, there's no side effects, and it's just great. Unfortunate thing, it's not covered by any insurance companies, but insurance companies, they're more interested in drugs. And so it's no coverage because it's an alternative treatment.
So that's not covered by like MVA
insurance
claims or whatnot. Is it because that's out of pocket?
That's out of pocket. So the therapies and treatments that I speak about or I wrote about in my most recent book, it's not covered by insurance companies because insurance companies, they've got some sort of relationship with OHIP and conventional and the pharmaceutical companies, because drugs, Western medical doctors, they get paid, and they get there's a big motivation for them to prescribe different drugs. And they're prescribing these drugs that are made by pharmaceutical companies. And those drugs, then eventually, if we have insurance, most of them might get covered through our extended health insurance, or possibly through OHIP.
Right.
So I see the insurance companies and the pharmaceutical companies sort of like they're in bed together, because they both need each other. And so if there's somebody prescribing, like Dr. Khan prescribing laser therapy is not going to have any benefit for the pharmaceutical companies, because I'm not using any drugs. And hence, it's not going to have any benefit for the insurance companies, because again, I'm not using any drugs or anything that they could get money for. So right. they will not cover that expense. And it's quite frustrating, but they'd rather spend thousands of dollars to cover me for these drugs, when this treatment, which is less expensive than the medication, is actually more effective.
Right.
And it'll get me back to functioning properly much quicker.
Right. So Anthony, do you experience chronic pain as a result of your brain injuries?
Yeah, well, not with the brain. I mean, I get headaches, absolutely. I don't know if I would call that chronic, but it's repetitive headaches, and I have pain in my body, like from my knee injury.
Right. So, like, I have chronic pain too. And for the life of me, I have not found anything to help me. This past winter, I tried, like a painkiller. And all it made me do, it was a placebo effect that made me want to eat prunes. It didn't help me with pain. I was still in pain, and I can't escape it. And I have not found anything to help me.
Where's the pain located? In your head?
Yeah, in my skull. So have you found any relief from chronic pain? And what do you tell your fellow injury survivors?
I mean, I've gone to laser therapy. Laser therapy's helped me greatly with my brain. It's helped me greatly with my body. Again, the pain that I experience is through headaches. And, you know,
yeah, me too.
I have to get a sleep. I have to get a proper sleep in order to deal with the headaches. And often that isn't the case. Sleep is a huge problem.
You do have trouble sleeping?
Yeah.
That is a big deal. I'm an awesome sleeper. But I do wake up with pain. And it's hard. So let's talk about this book. How was it received? Tell me about the people you've helped through your story.
Oh yeah, it's been very, received with a lot of open arms, and people really, really interested, because a lot of people are on the same sort of journey where they're continuing to have to see their medical doctors who are not really helping them deal with the problems. You see, with conventional Western medicine, they're going to prescribe you a pill, a medication, and that medication is really, it's like a Band-Aid solution. It covers up the problem temporarily, but it's not helping you deal with it on a long-term basis. That problem will come back again. And it's very ineffective, I mean, for the long-term. Whereas these alternative treatments, alternative therapies, they tend to get to the root cause of why the problem is occurring. I've gone to see different therapists. I've seen a homeopathy. Homeopathic therapists
right.
also deal on a more energetic, more cellular level of what is happening in the body. Why are you having these problems and experiencing these symptoms? And it's wonderful. And I never would have explored all that had it not occurred, had I not had a second brain injury. I would have just continued with the same route of taking prescription medications.
Right. So how do just regular people find these solutions, these alternative treatments that can better benefit them? Like, why is it it's not up to the brain injury survivor who has to rebuild themselves in their life to come up with these remedies for themselves?
Well, no, I mean, it's going to be very difficult. It's really by word of mouth.
Right.
If you're hearing people, I mean, I've given lots of talks and I've spoken about that. So many people have come up to speak to me about that.
So we kind of have to do our own research.
Yeah, you have to be very proactive in your approach to healing, because if you just sit around waiting, you're not necessarily people are going to give you what you need.
See, you're right. I was, my doctor this year, she referred me to the chronic pain program at the hospital in Sudbury. And it's May 15th. I'm still waiting for a call. I called them and they said, yes, we received your referral. We will go through the referral. Once it's accepted, we will give you a call. Well, I'm waiting. Hello, it's May 15th. Like, we're almost like halfway through the year. I'd like some answers. I'd like to find out if there's, I don't know if it's massage therapy or what the needles, acupuncture. I think acupuncture,
that's another big one.
I tried that a couple times through a physiotherapist and it was interesting. I'm not sure if I did it long enough to see results. It was mostly on the left side of my body.
Yeah, no, I tried that as well and it was quite effective.
What did it help you with?
That's something that's not covered by insurance. I got it's
no, that's true. See, and that's hard. We there's only so much that's covered under such and such coverage.
Yeah, it's so that's why I mean it's really up to the survivor. You've got to be proactive and go out and find ways to get yourself healed as opposed to waiting around, because if you wait around, you're going to be on a long waiting list and just waiting and waiting. And that's what was happening for me after my second brain injury, is that, oh my God, I got to go back to all this and waiting long periods of time, waiting to see a specialist with specialty in brain injuries. And it was just, so I wanted help then because I was so tired of here we go, another problem.
Right.
So that's why I started to explore very, very aggressively different possible treatments that might help me. And that ended up getting to this neuropsychologist who helped me so much and really opened my eyes to lots of different possible treatments.
That is amazing.
Yeah.
So we have 6 minutes left and I want to change gears. On a lighter note, you play guitar, you are a musician, and is that a form of your therapy?
Absolutely. My guitar is, I'm always with it. Anywhere I go, music is what's helped me greatly. In fact, anyways, music is very, very personal to me. When I was in a coma in the intensive care unit at St. Michael's Hospital, and the doctors, they had a private meeting with my parents. They told my parents that I was brain dead, and I was not going to come out of the coma. And if I did come out of the coma, I'd be a vegetable for the rest of my life. So they were suggesting to my family to have me removed from the life support system that was keeping me alive. And, you know, obviously very distressing news for the family. And my brother, my younger brother, Jonathan, he said, Mom, I got this great idea. Very smart guy. He ended up becoming an engineer. He said, Mom, how about I bring in Anthony's Walkman? See, back in 1997, we didn't have iPods or
anything. I remember Walkmans, yeah.
We had Walkmans. And so he brought in my Walkman to play my favorite music to me, even though I was in a coma. And he put my earphones on, and it was shortly thereafter that I became more responsive. And I started to actually exhibit some signs, which the doctors weren't able to get, like actually moving a toe on direction, or Anthony, move, hold, squeeze my hand. And so I started to come out, and the doctors were shocked and obviously embarrassed and amazed that, my God, they'd made a mistake. And they hadn't made a mistake. They according to their instruments and the limit of their assessments, it said that I was brain dead. And it says that about all the people who've gone through that. But my brother brought in this music, and it was also after Wayne Dyer saw me. My brother brought this music in that started to reconnect, create the reconnections in my brain. It started that process, and it was just amazing. So honestly, coming out of that, I love music. I can't stop it.
And I think your message right now is music heals.
Yeah, I love music, and
the
power of music is just so amazing.
Top 5 songs that you love to play.
I don't think I can give you a top because I love them all. I for me to say this is the best song, you know, what songs I know how to play. I mean, I love Hotel California.
Oh, that's a good one. Hey, play something for me. We have 3 minutes left.
Oh, right on the spot. Okay. I'm not going to play the whole thing. I have to look at the music. I forget the notes. Right. But no, I mean, this is my baby. It's very therapeutic. And lots of other people have stated the same thing, that music has helped them. And music therapy, there's a lot of validity in that. And there's no drugs. There's no insurance companies involved in that. It's you being proactive to healing yourself through what actually gives you a lot of energy and joy. And that's what we all can do.
And it's a love language.
Yeah. Who doesn't love music? I mean, music is the universal language that we all can speak and communicate, yeah, even though we come from different backgrounds.
And we'll all tap our foot to it. We'll all start dancing. It might be online right now, but you know, listening to music.
Well, thank you very much for this opportunity, Candace, and I'm really impressed with all that you're doing now.
Thank you. I'm so impressed with you and your recovery, too. It's nice to be able to support each other.
Yeah, well, thank you.
Even if it's from afar.
Keep doing what you're doing, because you're impressing a lot of people and helping a lot of people.
Thank you, Anthony. So are you.
Thank you so very much, Candace.
Thank you so much. Oh, what a great ending, Anthony. Anthony Aquinassi, everybody. Take care of you, my friend. Stay safe and keep reaching those goals.
Thanks so much. Okay, you take care, Candace.
Thanks, you too.
Okay, bye-bye.
Bye.